In this video, we'll review the 2011's Expert Mode options, these guys in this menu chart from the user manual. To enable these, simply drop down into the Expert Mode menu and check On. Normally, when the sensor detects an object, the output responds immediately. This On Delay feature allows you to delay that response. That way, you could use the detection of the object to trigger an operation that needs to occur after the leading edge of the object is detected, like marking or adhesive applications, stuff like that. You just dial in how much you want to delay the response, anything from 0 to 10 seconds, and you're done. How about that? The off delay is the same thing, except on the other end. It allows you to trigger another process long after the current object is gone. Just dial in whatever value you need. The off delay is disabled if you're using the pulse output, of course. Speaking of pulse output, if you select this option, you can specify the duration of the output signal. You can even use this pulse out feature with the on delay feature. This gives you a nice clean trigger for other operations. The filtering option gives you complete control over exactly how the output signal will be averaged. It's under this expert mode because you really need to understand what's going on to take full advantage of it and to avoid messing up the integrity of your measurements. Let's take a look. In this example, I have this half disc rotating in front of the sensor. So half the time the laser is bouncing off the surface, and the other half it's bouncing off this wall down here. The output of the sensor is set to voltage mode, and I have the range calibrated, so it only operates over this distance and not the full 3 meters. That just makes the output signal bigger. When a disc rotates, we see this kind of output at the A2 pin. This is when the disc is blocking the sensor, and this is when it's not. The disc is rotating 5 times per second. The sensor is taking measurements 500 times per second. So that means each one of these is covered by 100 measurements, right? So over here, this one cycle is measured 100 times. If we zoom in, we can actually see each measurement takes 2 milliseconds. With filtering, you can tell the sensor to average 1 to 500 measurements. Selecting 1 tells the sensor to take 1 measurement and output the result every 2 milliseconds. If I change filtering to 2, then that says take this sample plus the previous one, average those, and output that result. If the filtering is set to 10, take the previous 10 samples, average those, etc. You get the idea. Filtering is just how many measurements do you want to average. There is a problem with that though, right? Let's keep increasing the filter size and see what happens here. We know this signal is 100 measurements wide. What happens if I say I want the filtering to be 20 samples wide? Well, same thing as before. The sensor averages the previous 20 samples and sends that out. So that means this guy that would normally be here is now the average of all of these previous samples. So his value is going to drop somewhere down here, right? We don't actually get the full value until way over here when we're averaging these 20 samples. What that does is it creates a slope like this. And if I change filtering to 20, sure enough, that's exactly what happens. If we use a filtering setting of 50 samples, then in this example, there's only one time when we get a true low. That's when we average these 50 measurements. And there's only one time when we get a true maximum value. That's when we average these 50 measurements. The rest of the time, we get something in between. So now our output looks like this triangular waveform when a square object passes by, all because we averaged so many samples. Now if we take that to 100 samples, what happens now? Well, there's never a time when you don't have 50 large samples and 50 low samples, right? So you always get the same result, somewhere in the middle. And of course, 200 and 500 samples does the same thing. You just get an average of the whole waveform, which is something in the middle. Note that this also happens if we leave filtering at 50, but increase the speed of the disk to 10 RPMs. Let's try that one. Well, look, I left filtering at 50, and all I did was double the speed of the disk, and we just completely filtered out the entire object we were trying to detect. So the key is, when your filter size becomes longer than the time the object spends in front of the laser, you can actually completely filter out the object you wanted in the first place. So be careful with that. The good news is, when used correctly, this can be a real asset. For example, if you look at this disc, it has a hole in it. I'm going to line the laser up so it passes right over that hole. And sure enough, if I look at the output with an O-scope, I can actually see that glitch as the laser passes over that hole. So all I have to do is set up my filter to average enough samples to span that hole, and I can make the hole go away, right? Let's try it. Let's bump the filtering up to 5. I still see the glitch. I'm going to bump the filtering up to 10. Ah, now the hole's gone. Perfect. The only downside to that is it increases the slope of this edge by 10 samples. I can live with that, that's fine. So the bottom line is, filtering is very powerful for getting good, reliable, repeatable measurements and getting rid of little glitches. Just make sure you understand what's going on before trying to use it, and don't just randomly say, oh, I'll just use the maximum amount to get the best possible signal. It may not work for your application, especially if you're measuring small, fast-moving objects. You can enable or disable the laser from this menu. One thing to keep in mind, if you set up one of the I/O pins as a laser enable, so you can control the laser beam from an external switch, and you set that switch to turn the laser on, but then use this menu to turn the laser off, who wins? Well, the key thing to remember is if either one of these guys turns the laser off, it'll turn off. So in this example, the menu wins. The test menu is awesome. You can force individual output pins high or low, force an analog output to any value you want, either current or voltage, depending upon how you set the pin up, of course, and you can test any pins that are set up as inputs. Now what you see here depends on how you have your pins set up back in this menu, of course, but right now my sensor is set up with A1 as an input and A2 as an analog output. So those are the options I get. To test the input pin, I drop into that menu, apply a voltage to the input, and sure enough, the little pin bubble lights up. Cool. This is a great way to set up, calibrate, and test your system. I love that feature. This menu lets you set up the language used in all the sensor's menus. This menu tells you the information about the sensor, including the part number, software version, and serial number. This menu lets you reset the sensor to factory default. The default settings are shown in this chart in the user manual. And finally, you can set a password. Keep in mind, the password only prevents someone from gaining access after a power cycle. The password can be any four-digit number from 0 to 4 nines. Oh, by the way, if you forget your password, just email Wenglor at support@wenglor.com. They'll give you a master reset password so you can reset the sensor. Automation Direct's tech support is free, and you'll talk to a real live person here in the U.S. within minutes. Got a question? You can call, email, or even do online chat during regular business hours. AutomationDirect.com offers Wenglor distance measuring sensors from 80 micrometers all the way out to 100 meters to cover all of your distance measuring needs.